for that sort of thing. That was you. Other than that, learning stuff, nothing.
Yes.
So it was really exciting to see kind of the changes that are happening in the university. Can you explain kind of the whole market basket kind of thing that happened up in New England over the last year, and how that may have changed the way other companies might start treating their employees?
You mean the supermarket thing?
Yes.
Okay, you all know the story? It's a very cute. There's a chain, it's not very big, it's a chain in Massachusetts, I think, maybe a little bit New Hampshire, a supermarket chain. And it's a long story, it's a Greek family that owns the chain, and it had been, the elderly people, I think, had died, and it was now in the hands of two, they're either brothers or cousins, I don't, did you remember?
Yeah, my family's very involved.
Okay, so it's either brothers or cousins, I don't remember.
Yeah, they're cousins.
And one of them was like the fellow who just got bounced out of the University of Missouri. Hard business decisions, and he's going to run it in a tight ship, and all that other junk that those people say as if it were gospel, that. And the other guy is much looser, likes the workers, and bends over and thinks that if you treat workers right, it's a better business to have. And then there was struggle, and the bad one of the two got the enterprise. And the workers were really upset because they could see from what he had already done and what he was committed to that this was going to be now an unpleasant place to work. The communities that had gotten used to a different feeling at these workplaces because of the earlier, more generous guy. So then a very interesting thing happens, which is like what I've been trying to talk about. Suddenly, nobody quite knows how, the workers and many of the people in the communities served by these markets basically began to say, we don't accept that this guy, this relative of the family, is gonna run the store that way, versus we don't want him. We want the other one. Okay, well, this doesn't work in American capitalism. He had the legal things. He had gotten control. He had bought. And in our society, if you buy the thing and it's a legal transaction, you call the shots. There may be loads of people affected by what you do, but they have absolutely nothing to say. How exactly this squares with any notion of democracy has always been a mystery. A mystery for which no solution that I'm aware of has ever been found. It isn't democracy. It is the negation of democracy. It says precisely that the majority of people are not in a position to make the decisions about what happens to them. Somebody else is, who has no accountability to them. Those people said, no, that's it, we won't do it. And the stores stopped functioning. The workers didn't work, the community didn't buy, and the community and the workers then went to the local politicians and said, you're not gonna support him because he's all that he is him. We are your constituents, and there's a lot of us, and there's one of him. You figure it out, mayor, councilman, representative. And when you confront politicians, I'm going to say something like that later tonight, when you confront politicians with that kind of arithmetic, it's amazing how quickly they respond. They can see that one is one, and 84 is a larger number, they get that. And then they go with the larger number because they've learned that that's how politics works. And so, the store changed hands. Basically, the bad cousin.
The older CEO bought the family out, and they kicked all the people off the board, so all the old people came back, but it was the most well-run company. They had the employees had the best health care, they had the best profit sharing, but they had the lowest prices in the entire community, in the two states. And being able to provide for both the employees, but also the people. And people were literally taping their receipts from their other grocery stores to their windows, and their whole supply chain stopped. The truckers stopped bringing food and groceries. I mean, it literally was a standstill. And it was because the employees and the neighborhoods banded together and said, we won't stand for it.
These are, and we could go on all night. These are big straws in the wind, and that wind is changing. I am constantly surprised, and I don't make predictions. I don't believe in it, but as close as I can get, I'm telling you, you will see in the months and years ahead signs of this sprouting up in unlikely places all around you. That people are just, you've pushed them too far. I travel a lot in Europe. My folks are immigrants. My mother was born in Berlin, Germany. My father in France. And even though I was born in the United States, I grew up speaking French and German because my folks were refugees. They were running away from the Second World War. And the European, when I go back to Europe, over there, I do a lot, the question is always, we're having general strikes, we're having this, we're having that. What's with you in America? What's the matter with you? Are you all asleep? Are you taking too many tranquilizers? You know, just not for nothing, we as a people, we are 4 to 5% of the world's population. We consume 2/3 of the psychotropic drugs on this planet, legal and illegal. Now, either you assume that Americans are drug nuts, or there's a level of tension and unresolved conflict deep in all of us that finds its way into needing some chemical help. I go for the second explanation. I don't think Americans are that different from anybody else. So if we're doing that, it must be that we have got something maybe we can't talk about yet, but there's something roiling inside of us. And I think most of you know, because you feel it, and you probably know people in your neighborhood who do. You're going to read one more story about, I'll just pick someone at random, Donald Trump. You know, one more boastful, I'm going to make a wall, and yeah. What? We just discovered in New York City that a one-bedroom apartment, the average across all of our five boroughs, you know, we have very, very rich parts of Manhattan and very, very poor parts of, say, the Bronx. I mean, it's a city of enormous contrast. The average one-bedroom apartment in New York now costs $1 million. The average. Okay. So something is going on that's producing literally obscene wealth at one end and a vast sea of people who are having trouble getting their kid through college and all the rest of it. This bothers people, whether they show it or say it. Mm-hmm. May take a year before they can finally have it up to here. But watch out. There's an old added kind of argument in psychology. The people for whom it takes longer, when it blows, ooh, it has accumulated a level of pressure. You may have noticed in your own life that if you have a problem with your partner and you don't say anything about it, then when it finally comes out, you realize it would have been better if you had said it earlier when it wasn't quite so horrible yet. The same thing is in a larger society. So
100,000 households in 7 counties that are unable to consistently afford the cost of living in Florida. Something's happening in the U.S. This didn't happen in 1968 or 1970. Something definitely is happening. And here to talk about it is Professor Richard Wolff, Professor Emeritus of Economics from the University of Massachusetts. He taught economics there from 1973 to 2008. He's currently a visiting professor in the graduate program in international affairs of the New School University of New York City. He also teaches classes regularly at the Brecht Forum in Manhattan. I present to you Dr. Richard Wolff.
At least now you get to see what the voice looks like. I will keep my New York accent just so as to not disorient you. I was, however, born in Youngstown, Ohio. It's just that nothing stuck in Youngstown, Ohio. And once we left, as you probably know, if you visited there, it's been all downhill since. Youngstown is one of those cities about which the capitalist system would like you to think nothing about it, because if you faced it, you'd understand what the cost of this kind of an economic system is. But then again, it's true of Youngstown, it's also true of Cleveland and Detroit and many other places that we'll have something to say about as we go on this evening. Let me begin with a couple of comments about favors I need to ask you before we jump into the topic. The first one is that as I go along and describe what happened, what could happen in our economic system, there may be moments when what you hear is distressing, or depressing, or horrible. And I want you to remember, I didn't cause anything. I'm just the messenger. And there's an old rule that it's not good to hurt the messenger just because you don't like the message. And there is an easy alternative if the things I say trouble you about the economy we live in. The thing you can do is tune me out and resume watching radio and television reports in the mass media, and none of these troubling insights will disturb your sleep or your waking hours. That's always an option. The second, how for the last 50 years, the last part of that coalition was destroyed, the labor movement, which has been declining as a percent of our employees in a 50-year slide that doesn't end. And then literally these days looks like it will go to zero. For those of you who don't know, the percentage of people in the private sector, which is the largest part of our economy, the percentage of workers in the private sector who are members of or represented by a labor union is now under 7%. 93% of private sector workers do not have a union and are not represented by a union. The next time you hear some, I'm polite again, conservative politician telling you about how he or she is fighting big corporations and big unions, you are listening to a certified moron. But it's a moron with an ideological task to perform to give you the idea that there's something there which has long since disappeared, if it ever existed. But here's what happened to the American people in the course of hounding out the communists and hounding out the socialists and trampling all over the labor movement. You did teach Americans better than they understand. Don't go near a collective organization. Don't join something that's about politics and social change. That's dangerous. That's not smart. That's not going to help your career. That's going to make your neighbors look at you funny. It's going to worry your children. It's going to hurt you. Don't do it. I remember watching my fellow students as they got interested in and then backed away from radical ideas in economics. Not because they didn't agree with them, but because they understood, rightly, that that was a bad career choice. Don't go there. And I knew, as I did go there, that I was doing that. I knew it. You need a psychiatrist to understand why I did it, but I did it. And they didn't. And many of them were my good friends, so I really did understand. And that's one of the reasons why we don't act in this crisis the way our fellow Americans did back in the 1930s. We haven't done it. It's not because we're stupid, and it's not because we're frightened. It's because we're coming out of a hibernation of 50 years in which we didn't do it, in which we were told it was scary, dangerous, and troubling, and self-destructive to go anywhere near that kind of stuff. That's why young people in America, even when they get involved, are nervous about an organization, need to reassure themselves all the time that they won't lose their individual independence. It's like what a lot of women discover in men about having a relationship. Men are worried about the disappearance of an independence they never actually had. They think they ought to hold on desperately. It's the same kind of gut level fear that takes time with a skilled professional to figure out. So we're a country that couldn't do it. Even when it flares up, like Occupy, it flares up, it teaches us in a sudden moment, oh, there are a lot of people who think this way. And look at them, they're camping in the downtown park in 350 cities. It was really impressive in those late months of 2011. But they couldn't sustain the organization. They couldn't build the organization that keeps these things going and builds. They were nervous. They called themselves anarchists, not because they had a commitment to that particular perspective, but because they wanted to show they were not organized, and they were free of that scary business whose origin in their own history they didn't know. So that's what happened, a mass movement to support rules and regulations, because their answer will be, we've been there, we've done that, we're not going to do that again. Either you come up with another plan that offers us a real chance to make things different, or we're not going to do anything. We're going to hunker down and get through this as best we can, individually. And that's a recipe for disaster. So what is it? What can we offer? Well, before I conclude by telling you what I think the answer is, as some of you know, knowing what I talk about, what I write about, I want to give you one more, at the risk of distressing the gentleman in the room. I want to give you a story about the future of America by once again rendering a picture of its past. In 1970, presidents of the United States brought foreign dignitaries to Detroit to show them a successful American capitalist city. It had almost 2 million people back then. It was a bustling center of enterprise. It gave workers a fantastic job, because of the most powerful union in this country at that time, the United Auto Workers. Not only did it give good jobs, it gave, and this was really amazing, to a growing number of African Americans coming up from the South, good jobs too. We're not good at that in this country. We weren't then, we still weren't. But one of the reasons the president went to Detroit with his visitors was you could even make the case that African-American working people had a decent job with security, with benefits, could put their kids to school, etc., etc. So extraordinary was the opportunity, particularly for African-Americans, that they were not only able to live properly, but they were incredibly creative, as well cared for people always are. They created a brand new music. The Motown sound was transformed. Music in the world also comes out of Detroit, also comes out of the auto factories. Amazing. Okay, now, fast forward, 2015, Detroit. Population of Detroit, the most stark way I know how to get this across briefly, today, it's about 700,000 people. But let me do that again. 2 million in 1970, 700,000. The majority of the people of Detroit were driven out of the city in the last 40 years. Something like a third to a half of the housing stock in the city is abandoned. A good part of it burnt to the ground. For a time, there was, I understand it isn't anymore, but for a time there was a problem of wild dogs in Detroit. Because it turns out that as families were leaving, because they had no job anymore, because the city was falling apart, they said a tearful goodbye to Fido and left him in Detroit as they went away. Meanwhile, the city of Detroit, with nobody working, had no money, no taxes, so they laid off the dog wardens. Okay, now you got dogs, abandoned houses where dogs can do something which I can't discuss. And no dog wardens to impede the process. The result is an explosion of dogs, and they become a danger. I'm not describing some far-off corner of the world. I'm describing what was, not that many years earlier, the most successful example of a capitalist industrial city anywhere. For the 40 years that Detroit went from what it was in 1970 to what it is today, an endless list of mayors, governors, and presidents watched like deer caught in the headlights, while this disintegration, and now Detroit, for those of you who pay attention, is the largest urban bankruptcy in the history of the United States. It is a disaster in millions of people's lives who were destroyed, who were ripped out of their homes, their neighborhoods, their families, their churches, you name it. Many of them went to another city like Cleveland, where the same thing happened again. Or Dayton, or Toledo, or my hometown, Youngstown, or countless others. For those of you who've never been to a place called Camden, New Jersey, go. Go sometime. Nothing I could tell you will prepare you for what you will see. That's true for Detroit, too. This is the future of the United States. Why do I say it? Because it's the history. What destroyed Detroit was a simple decision made by about 35 men. 35 men on the boards of directors of Ford, General Motors, and Chrysler. They decided that they could make more money for themselves and their shareholders by moving auto production out of Detroit to Mexico, to Canada, to China, to wherever they could go. And that's what they've been doing. And in our capitalist system, this is called the profit motive. This is called free or private enterprise. They do what is best for them to do, because that's their job. If they didn't do that, they would be fired. That's the way capitalism works. It's true. That's how it works. There was a demonstration in Bangladesh, the capital, Dhaka, a couple months back. huge number of people walking down the main street of Dakar carrying signs demanding a minimum wage of $100 per month, 40 hours a week, minimum per month. How are you going to compete with this? You're not. That's why you're all wearing clothes not made here. Much of your car that you drove to come here is not made here. Your camera isn't made here, your TV isn't made here, your toaster isn't made here. You get the picture, you know, you don't need me for this. And that's not for any other reason than it's profitable. That's why it's done. Those workers are cheap. And you know the consequences, I hope. It's not only decimated cities like Detroit or Cleveland or Camden or countless others. It's also the absolute ecological lunacy. Once upon a time, your shirt had to travel a couple hundred miles from producer to your closet. Now it has to travel 10,000 miles from China, polluting the ocean, polluting the air. Why is this horrible destruction? Because it's profitable. And because the companies that pollute don't have to pay for the costs of your cough, your emphysema, your asthma. It's a peculiar system that allows decisions to be made by people who are not accountable for the consequences of their decision. That's a system that is irrational, that has lost its capacity to justify its existence. But we gotta face something. The profit motive built capitalism from its origins in England in the 18th century to around the 1970s by building all of its facilities in Western Europe, in North America, in Japan. That's where the factories were, that's where the storehouses were, that's where the stores and the offices were. And we all, Americans, had jobs in that process because capitalism focused itself where it started. Yeah, we fought for higher wages, we had to, but we got them in part because capitalism was focused here. In the 1970s, that all stopped. Corporations had a eureka moment, like in the comic book, you know, little window opens up, you have that great insight. The corporation said, why are we concentrating all of our offices and stores and factories in the United States and Western Europe and Japan, where we've been forced by our strikes and our unions to pay high wages? Why don't we take advantage of jet engines, which allow us to get anywhere in the world in a matter of hours, and telecommunications, which allow us to monitor what our workers are doing in a plant 10,000 miles away as easily as before we monitored across the street? We don't have to produce where the wages are high. We can move to where they aren't. And they did. That's why Detroit looks the way it does. That's real as opposed to rhetorical. If you have any concept of democracy as urgent, the first place it should have been instituted is the workplace, because that's where the adults are most of the time. Instead, we have a workplace that has been undemocratically organized from day one. Of course the people who run our enterprises use their control for themselves. Look, if I had time, I would have spent this evening talking to you, although you already know, that one of the problems of capitalism, besides its instability, craziness, is the inequality that it produces. Some of you know there was that famous French economist, Thomas Piketty, who last year had a bestseller, Capital in the 21st Century, in which he shows carefully in 600 odd pages of statistical work how and why capitalism always and everywhere produces a growing inequality of income, which is only stopped or reversed when there's a mass upheaval like in the 1930s that I told you about before, which reverses it for a while, until the capitalists can once again resume normal business, but it creates this crazy inequality. This is a fantastic craziness, and it comes right out of our capitalist system. Inequality in our society has fundamentally to do with how the net revenue, surplus, like the profits of enterprise, how are they distributed? In case you're not familiar, the way a corporation works is the major shareholders, the people who own big blocks of shares, have a vote each year to decide who's on the board of directors. That's how you get to be on the board of directors. You are elected by the shareholders. The rule is one vote per share. If you own one share, you get one vote. If you own a million shares, you get a million votes. And if you own no shares, that's how many votes you get. The vast majority of people in America don't own a significant amount of shares. 1% of share owners own 2/3 of all the shares. That's the 1% who make the decisions. They elect the boards of directors, and they decide what to do with the profits. Imagine with me, because you've been there, the Christmas party at the corporate headquarters. Everybody's gathered, drinking and eating too much, and eventually the CEO stands on the table, wobbles with his excess alcohol, and gives the following speech. I want to thank everybody here, because everybody in this room contributed to making the profits we enjoyed, and I want to thank you. It's interesting. Everybody contributed to the profits that a board of directors, typically 15 people, is going to decide what to do with. You all contributed, but we decide. And here comes something that will really shock you. The board of directors, together with the major shareholders that put them there, decide to distribute the profits everybody helped to produce, mainly to themselves. What a surprise. They declare a dividend. That's the portion of the profits that go to the shareholders. And they decide what bonuses and other compensation is given to the top executives, which is what they are. And so they give it to themselves and they become very rich, and you don't. But this is because you've let them be the decision makers about what is done with what you helped to produce. You are going to have trouble getting your kid to college. They're trying to figure out how big a yacht to get this month. Well, you live with this. This can't go on, or let me put it differently. If you don't stop it, it will go on. Until there's nothing for you. Until you become the people that other countries will be watching on television saying to themselves, well, at least we don't live like that. What does it mean to democratize the enterprise? Simple. Imagine the workers together will decide how to distribute the profits they all together help to produce. What an odd idea that you who help to produce it get to have a say in what's done with it. And guess what? If people generally divided it up, you think they'd give a handful of already rich people a lot of it, and they themselves wouldn't be able to send their kids to school? Not gonna happen. You want to do something finally about the inequality in the United States? Don't fool around with the taxes. Don't fool around with the rules. Stop it. That has never worked. And even the few times when it worked, it never endured. It's not a good thing in a society to give someone an income and then come up with a rule that takes the money back from them. Redistributing income is what that is, makes people hate and fight with each other. Here's a smarter idea. Don't distribute it unequally in the first place. Then you won't need to have a struggle over redistribution. And if the workers themselves decided to distribute it, and if the workers themselves decided to distribute it in a democratic way, we we would do something finally about inequality instead of whining about it, we would actually do something. But here are some other advantages of a democratic workplace. Question, do you use a new technology that's really bad for the air and bad for the water and noisy and hurts people? Well, it's more profitable, you're told. It is, it'll increase profit, but it'll hurt them. If you're the 10 people or 15 people on the board of directors, well, let's make the extra profit. After all, I live in a gated community 40 miles from here. I'm not going to be upset by this. I don't care if the water's no good. I have filtered water brought to my house 3 times a day anyway. The people who now make the decision vote for the higher profits, even if it's a disaster for the environment. Now imagine a work collective democratic workplace. You're not going to make that same decision, because you and your spouse and your children and your neighbors, they're all living there. They're all going to live with the economic and political and natural personal consequences. They will like higher profits too, but they're going to really weigh what it means for most people to live in a polluted environment. You're going to do something about pollution on a scale you haven't before. Here's another example. The board of directors says, hey, if we move production to Shanghai, we're going to make more money. A worker, democratic run enterprise, we would make more money, but we would have no jobs. And our community would have no taxes. And that's no good. And that's not going to happen. That's not going to happen. Whoa, you mean the last 40 years of American history, the abandonment by capitalism of the United States, because that's what it is, wouldn't have happened if the workers had democratically chosen whether or not to lose their livelihoods or not. That's not a hard one. That's kind of easy. So we would have had less inequality, less ecological destruction, less loss of jobs in the first place, and a much more democratic workplace. Whoa, why aren't we doing this? Why do you need me to come here and give you a talk about this? You know that this is a better idea. You do. You knew it before I said anything about it. But we've been afraid, because this isn't capitalism anymore. This is a different system. This is a system that says the first priority is to give people a decent standard of living that includes an honest job that they can go to with a good feeling each day, earn a life, bring up their children, and all the rest, which is what most people want and need. And we've just been afraid to criticize a system that is increasingly incapable and uninterested in doing that. But we really don't have to be. Think of it politically with me for a concluding moment. We're asking for something that this country, including its current leaders, like to talk about. Democracy. We want to bring democracy to the workplace. We are currently in a crazy situation where we are bombing 6 countries around the world to bring them a democracy we don't have. You can see why they might be just a tad skeptical. They're getting the bombs, but the democracy seems slow in arriving. And we know why, and they do too. What does it take? Well, as I said to some of you before this evening, I'm going to conclude this way. I am speaking critically and sharply against a capitalism that I don't think works anymore. Not for the mass of people, maybe for a few, but But even for them, a growing number are afraid. Warren Buffett, one of the richest people on the planet, is afraid. He's afraid that this is a system spinning out of control in which those at the top are taking such an enormous portion of everything for themselves that they are literally setting themselves up for the fall. And that the rest of the people won't continuously allow this to proceed, and he is afraid, and he's not alone. This is an arrangement that doesn't make sense. Germany today, which is arguably the most successful of the capitalist countries anywhere, Germany has in place much stricter rules than we do about when a company can leave, has to get approval from its unions, from workers, from the community. You can't do anything like we have corporations to do. That's because of the labor and union movements and the socialists and communists in Germany. You may not know it, but in Germany, every company that has 2,000 or more employees has to give one half of the seats on the board of directors to workers elected by other workers. That's the law in Germany. That's because they haven't changed their system. They still have a capitalist system. The capitalist is still in control, but it shows you you can go much further than we have. But I'm not arguing that we do that. I could regale you, and I know how it works because I do it sometimes in audiences. I could regale you with the fact that in France, as in most European countries, when you enter the labor force after finishing high school or college, your employer is required by law, in France, for example, to give you 5 weeks of paid vacation. Did you know that? Most Americans don't get 5 weeks paid vacation ever. There you get it right from the beginning. And you don't bargain it, and you don't know. It's the law. It's the law. I taught as a visiting professor at the University of Paris a few years ago, and discovered that the professor there that brought me earns about what I do in the United States, but with two differences. His four-year-old daughter goes to a daycare maintained in the center of Paris, and he had to pay at that time 21 euros a week. She could come as early as 7, could stay as late as 7. She had her own outfit provided by the daycare center, all the meals she wanted, etc., etc. And the other way he was different from me was that it cost in those days, and it's about the same now, to go to the University of Paris, $240 per semester total. But that's not what I'm arguing about. I'm not arguing for that. That's more, and don't take this as a criticism because it's not meant that way, that's more of what Bernie Sanders has in mind. I'm arguing about something else. I'm arguing that we learn a history lesson of our country. We've got to change the way businesses are owned and operated and run. Otherwise, we're not serious. Even if we win advances, they can and will be taken away from us by the people who have the incentive and who are left by us with the resources to do it. Finally, to change this means we have to be strong enough and determined enough to say a workers' cooperative integrated with the communities in which these workers and these enterprises live and work, democratically run by the community, is the alternative system. I don't care what label you put on it. It's a way of getting the results, less inequality, less instability, less ecological damage, less abandonment of the United States, and a much more democratic system. That's how we can do it. Co-ops, whatever if you like to call them that, have been around for centuries. It's not a new idea, but it's an idea that is now showing itself to be a way forward. And it can work in the United States because the conventional defenses of capitalism never saw this coming. They're big about being angry at the government, seeing socialism as the government doing everything. We're not talking about that. We're talking about the people themselves at the base controlling the production of wealth. That's what, in the end, power comes from. It's also the best defense against an overpowering state. The state will never be able to do what it did in those early efforts at socialism in Russia and China, because it had the wealth. This is a story about the wealth being in the hands, finally, of the mass of people. I don't like to reduce things to slogans, but here's one to think about. If you want an economic system to serve the needs of the people, then you have to put the people in charge. We've not done that as a society. We've allowed a tiny minority of people to sit at the top of the economic pyramid and to be able to use that position to aggrandize themselves at everyone and else's expense. And those people aren't stupid. I know a lot of them personally. They long ago understood that if a society becomes as unequal as ours is, those at the top always have to worry that the mass of people will use politics to undo the inequality created by a capitalist economy. We will use the power of universal suffrage, the vote, to vote in the rules and the regulations. So they've made sure that the politics in this country cannot work that way. And they did that very well by making the politician and the party dependent not on you and me, not on machines, not on voters, not on public opinion, but on money. That's what they got. And so if it's dependent on money, they can make sure that what the political forces do and what you and I want have very little to do with one another. But that doesn't mean they have it locked up. Those officials at the University of Missouri, they thought they had their situation locked up. Turns out, they didn't. And if going around the country, doing my radio show, having people like you come to events like this, is part of a process of beginning the movement that will finally change all of this and reorganize the enterprises of this country so that they work in a fundamentally different way, we can solve the problem. I am, as you can tell, I hope, from my tone, I am, in the end, optimistic at least about what's possible. And because the last few years have been, for me personally, just so you know, an extraordinary demonstration, I hope those of you who heard this a little bit earlier tonight will not mind my ending this way. Over the last couple of months, I've spoken in every corner of the United States. In the next week, I'll be, after I leave here, I have speeches in Houston and Ames, Iowa. But everywhere, the response, the mood, the anger, the determination is what I never saw before, what I never expected to see in my lifetime. I'm enormously elated at the change in the consciousness. It's always the first step. So speaking is not tiring for me, it isn't. Even though you can tell, I'm not 20 years old. And as I said before, just so you know, I am having the time of my life.
ovation.
It's important above all that you look around and look at each other and figure out who you're going to talk to, who you're going to meet with, who you're going to bring to your living room, and who you're going to find out who they know and who they can bring to whose living room, and how you can use this radio station, which is a crucial resource.
Yes.
St. Petersburg area had a coordinated, committed, determined core of, what have we got, 400 folks, more or less, that's it. That's more than you need to transform a community. You know, Margaret Mead, a great anthropologist, once said, don't make fun of six or seven people who get together to try to change the world. That's how the world has been changed every single time. That's how it starts. And then it grows. You already have more than six or seven, as you can probably see. That's the name of the game. Once you're motivated, once you are in movement, everything becomes possible. And that's the hope. And then, believe me, I am doing everything I know how to facilitate motivate exactly that, and you already are ahead of most places by having this community able and willing to come out on this evening to do this. So my hat's off to you, and thank you for your kindness, but I also want to applaud what you are able to do.
Self-directed enterprises. How is that coming, and can you share any of those experiences with us?
Yeah, the question was about some steps we're taking in our organization, Democracy at Work, to actually help existing businesses that would like to go convert from a top-down hierarchical capitalist enterprise into a worker cooperative, a democratic enterprise. So to speak about that very briefly, yes, we have done that. We've entered into a contract with a firm in New York City that has been doing this for 20 years. It includes lawyers and accountants and people with specialized expertise in lending. And basically, it means that we can now do something we weren't able to do. Up until now, mostly what I've been doing and what the others in my group do is to go around and try to make the best case we can, as I tried tonight, for what it is we think has to be done. But then when people actually came up and said, well, I have such and such a business, I'm ready to go, I agree, I want to do it, well, we had to kind of put up our hands and say, well, the technical part of it is not what we know. We can't really help you there. So we felt that this was not a very happy response to those people. So these folks are experts, that's what they do. And so we're now able to say, when a group comes to us and says, well, we're ready to go, we now have the team that will immediately sit down with them and work out the legal arrangements, the financial, everything you need to do it. And let me give you just a couple of examples. Side, dead end, and they're not gonna do it. And they're not even gonna take more than occasional jabs at Bernie Sanders because they assume that it's hopeless for anybody who allows the term socialist to be associated with his or her name to get anywhere, and that he will fade away, and that all of the people excited by him will take one look at Hillary Clinton and compare her to whatever it is the Republicans do and then vote for her. That's their assumption. They don't even hide this. This is the way they understand it. I think Hillary Clinton's position is best summarized by that phrase of hers that I quoted earlier, and I'll quote again. Sometimes you have to save capitalism from itself. She's the savior. She's going to do that. she's going to try to modify its rough edges. You know, in Europe, there's a phrase for this, capitalism with a human face. In other words, you have capitalism, but you round out its rough edges, you smooth down its harsher realities. That's what my understanding is of what she's about. What Bernie Sanders says is that he's part of the socialist tradition. And that means, at least it used to mean, something other than capitalism, that you're not trying to save capitalism, you're trying to move to something else. There's a huge disagreement among socialists as to what that other thing is. Bernie Sanders has what in Europe is called social democracy, as a kind of regulated, limited, very much of a human face for socialism. He wants to do what the socialists that are in power in many European countries do when they're in power. And that is provide, like I said, 5 weeks paid vacation, a free or nearly free higher education. Bread, for example, in France is subsidized. Those of you that have ever gone to France and bought those wonderful baguettes that they serve, those are cheap because the government, since the French Revolution, has subsidized bread. Also in France, if you have more than one child, you get a direct subsidy to help you pay for the cost of feeding and clothing your child. You see, there's a whole host. These are the things that Bernie said. When it comes to what I said about transforming how enterprises, then that's much less developed, for example, in Bernie Sanders. In his program, he says he's in favor of worker co-ops. He says that, and that's already, nothing like that appears in Hillary Clinton, not a word about it. So he says it, but he keeps it a low key, at least so far, kind of topic. And I think that's because he thinks a capitalism with a human face, a kind of, let's call it the most moderate kind of socialism, is already daring in the American context. And I understand why he does that. He's been a senator for a long time. He grew up in his political life in Vermont, which is a special place. And you know, it's one of our smallest states, and you can get to know kind of almost everybody. It's a different world than, say, Florida or Ohio or New York or states. So he managed it there. His personal dimension, his hard work, the way he presented himself, got the people of Vermont to say, okay, there's a socialist that's a little strange, but seems like a good guy and a nice guy, and okay. And this is going to be a harder thing for him to do, especially when, if he gets anywhere, the barbs will get harsher. But that's a different generation. I don't mean because he's old, and I'm old too, but it's a different idea of what's possible. I'm pushing much further than he is, as you can tell. But I'm doing that because I can. I don't have the pressure. I'm not in the position he is. I'm not knocking him. We have different roles to play. He opens up part of what has to be opened up. I gotta open up some other parts. I have to be out there saying what I say, because once someone says it the first time, it's much easier for everybody else. I'm perfectly happy. That's part of what happens when you go to elite schools. I was telling the group that I met with before tonight that I went to fancy school. My folks had no money. I went to Harvard and Stanford and Yale. I'm like a joke of the elite education in the United States. Wave my pedigrees and hope that they stop bothering.
So we've only got time for one more question, maybe two. Who's got the best question? So, you know, I feel like this side of the room has not been treated well. So let's, who's got the best question that's not been asked? This guy? All right, stand up. And could you take the microphone over there, please?
That'd be good.
Obviously, we were recently inspired. shattered by the events that took place on the Missouri campus. I just wanted to get your opinion or view as an economist, what you think or how you think the capitalist system would react should a mass student movement come together with athletes, groups, not only walk off campus, but also refuse to pay a dime back of the student loan debt.
All I can say is, go for it. I didn't mean it, but let me just clarify. No one knows how exactly a situation like ours hits that point when suddenly everything shifts. A great, great political leader once put it in ways I'll never forget. Here's what he said. For decades, nothing happens. And then, in a few weeks, decades happen. That's right. If anyone had come to me in the summer of 2011, they didn't, but had they come to me and said, we have this plan, we're going to set up pup tents in a little park in downtown Manhattan, Zuccotti Park by name, and we're going to have food for homeless people and a little library, and we're going to really spark a nationwide. I would have thought they were nuts. I would have said that sounds like nobody will care, and you'll sit there in this silly park and no one will pay attention, and then you'll all go home. And you will have wasted a lot of time and energy. I'm so glad they never came, because had I said that, I'd be ashamed the rest of my life, because I was so wrong. That gesture of getting some people in a tent in a park was the right thing to do. It made, in a short term, because I went and spoke at a bunch of them, I went to Bangor, Maine. Let me tell you, that is the middle of no place. don't repeat this to my friends. It's Bangor, Maine, and there in the middle of the town, green, New England green, are a whole bunch of tents and people having a wonderful time discussing how to change society. It was fantastic, and it wasn't everywhere else that I went. It was the right thing, but who would have foreseen? You know, it's like in chemistry. I once studied chemistry before I figured out that wasn't for me, and I learned about something called a supersaturated solution. That's a liquid in which an awful lot of something has dissolved. But you get it to a certain point, and one more teeny piece of that solid is dropped in there, and it suddenly converts from a liquid to a solid. It's just on the edge of a transformation. That's my sense of where the United States is. So I can't say do this or do that. I don't think anybody can, but I know I can. And so my answer really is, go for that. Let's see. Let 1,000 people in different circumstances try, and we will learn what works, what moves the American people. Nobody knows. But for sure, in a country as riddled with debt as we are, if one part of the indebted, the people with the mortgages they can't handle, the people with the car payments they can't handle, the people with the credit card debt they can't handle, or the students with the college loans they can't, one of them stands up and says, that's it, we are not playing this game anymore. Who knows, but maybe that'll finally give the homeowners the backbone they need to say no. Maybe that'll transform this country in ways that we cannot foresee. So my response is what I said. Go for it, try it, work at it. I'm sure those athletes in Missouri wondered to themselves what they were getting into. Had no idea things would go that quickly. They couldn't have. But now we all stare at the reality of what was achieved there, and wonder to ourselves, like you are, what about another bold step? Yes, that's when societies change, when all kinds of people begin to make the experiments that the rest of us will learn from and begin to chart out how we move. People who come in with a ready-made plan of how to go, those are people you should find someone else to talk to.
Okay, so we've got time for one more question. We've got two men. I think it's only fair that we get the last question from a woman. So, in fairness, is there a last question from a woman? If no woman steps, is there? Well, no, Beth, if you don't mind. But some, is there a woman who has
I'm going to get a sex change.
Okay,
I'm transgender.
Go ahead.
And the question is whether something awful, more or less, has to happen, or something drastic. Yeah, I mean, the answer is that sometimes is the spark that takes people over the edge, finally says, well, that's one too many things. The TPP could be in a kind of skeptical because it's so lost in the combination of voluminous detail and secrecy that it's very hard to figure out what it's about, let alone a program about it. I mean, it's clear that it's not going to do any of us any good, this sort of thing. But we weren't being held much by the existing rules of international trade, so it's not clear that this is actually going to make us much worse off. But there's not, the mass of people are not involved. So yeah, it may be something awful, I can give you actually a sense of the Sometimes I'm captured by my technical assists. I think more like the kind of thing if you want to think creatively about what the risks are in the financial press right now. There is a good bit of agreement that the year 2016 and 2017 are not going to be good economically. We're going to have another downturn. As usual, no one knows for sure when it'll happen or how bad it'll be, and I'm not going to pretend that I know any better than anybody else. But the signs are accumulating that we're going to have a start.
I would love to see, for example, worker co-ops make a decision. We don't want big business. We want small. We think there are, and so we'll pay a price. Certain things we won't be able to get because we want small. You know, my family is French. In every French city, the majority of stores are small because the French people don't, I mean, they have them, but they don't want the supermarket.
Yeah.
They don't want the department store. Yeah. They want that little
boulangerie. They want, yeah.
That's right, where they know the family and they want that piece of meat cut that way. It's just, you know, it's a notion that that's the way they want to live their life.
I guess what I was speaking to is that their idea about scale, though, and human scale, and Wendell Berry is the same way about how it affects the, you know, the working class, how it affects people on the ground floor, right?
It's like talking to an architect. Suddenly you become aware that a big glass building is not the be all and end all of architecture, and is in fact an awful place. And that you might, what do you want this for? Why are you living like this? You know, before you just go ahead and allow them, when it's dictated half by economics anyway, and why are you doing this?
Well, what did Jefferson say? He said, the biggest threat to our republic are the bankers and the speculators. Just what you were talking about.
Which segues into Paul Gringon, Money is Debt, on YouTube. Have you watched that series?
Is it good?
Yeah, you absolutely have to watch it. And then you have to give an analysis of the creation of money for your listeners.
Yeah, in New York?
Yeah, I recorded that, the panel discussion with you and Christopher Hedges and Cornel West. I serialized that and played it in my radio program, and it's an entirety in like 10 to 15 minute sections. played the whole thing. It was great.
Marked it up into those seconds.
Yeah. I played it in consecutive weeks of my radio program for like 7 weeks.
You may do it again.
Great. Because that's one of the most intelligent conversations I've ever heard. It was fantastic.
We're going to have Tom Payne.
Yeah, Tom Payne. That was really good. So